Well, let's start our afternoon session. And our first speaker is Rafael Vitola about WDBV equations and invariant Hamiltonian formulae.
Good afternoon. I would like to thank the organizers for their kind invitation. Andrei Konstantinovich Pogrebkov was a constant presence in my department, and I am especially happy to celebrate his birthday. Today I will speak.
Thanks a lot. Thanks.
Well, I have another slide about you in the end. So I would like to speak about WDBV equations and invariant bi-Hamiltonian formulas. WDBV equations are a central topic in integrable systems. And some quantum field theories, like topological field theory, for example. I will be mostly concerned about some mathematical aspects of the WDBV equations, so I will not focus on the physical significance. So the WDBV equations acquired very high mathematical importance due to the work of Boris Anatolievich Dubrovin in the 90s. And I would like first to introduce them, as Boris Dubrovin did in his seminal paper, Geometry of Two-Dimensional Quantum Field Theory, Topological Field Theory. So, by the way, the aspects on which I will focus more are related to the bi-Hamiltonian formalism of the WDBV equations. So, in order to do that, I would like to discuss some topics in the bi-Hamiltonian geometry, and then I will introduce the WDBV equations. So first of all, I would like to introduce a class of Hamiltonian operators, four PDEs, that was introduced by Dubrovin and Novikov in 1983. Such operators were introduced motivated by studies stemming from fluid dynamics. And in particular, mathematical studies of quasi-linear first-order partial differential equations, which several people in the Russian school call hydrodynamic PDEs. I will be concerned only with the case of two independent variables, time and one space dimension. And then, a quasi-linear first-order system of PDEs has a homogeneous first-order Hamiltonian operator, if and only if the system can be written in this form, where P1 and H1 are as follows. H1 is a density which depends only on the field variables. The field variables can be as many as you wish. They depend on the two independent variables. And the Hamiltonian operators are of the form which is written here. So they are homogeneous in the sense that x derivatives appear the same number of times in every summand. Oh, this operator P1 is homogeneous of first degree. And this means that it will be first order with respect to the derivative of the operator. And there are blocks which are of zero order, but they are multiplied by first order derivatives. So homogeneity is respected, homogeneity with respect to number of x derivatives. So why considering such operators? Because there are examples. They came from Euler fluid dynamics and were observed first by Novikov, I think. And then the Hamiltonian property of such operators is nice under the differential geometric viewpoint, because if you do a change of coordinates in the U's only, you will see that the form of the quasi-linear first-order system is preserved, but also the form of the homogeneous Hamiltonian operator and the Hamiltonian H1 is preserved. And this means that everything behaves geometrically. Moreover, if you compute the properties by which P1 defines a Poisson bracket, such properties are geometrically invariant and they can be expressed indeed by tensor conditions. So, okay, why, what is the interest such operators in the context of WDVD equations? Well, the point is that a solution of the so-called WDVD equations, WDVD stands for Witten Dijkgraaf Verlinde-Verlinde. A solution, as was proved by Dubrovin in 96, here there is a mistake, probably, there is a mistake. So in 96, a solution provides a compatible pair of first order homogeneous operators, as I shown in the previous slide. So whenever you have a solution, you have a pair of operators which are Hamiltonian and are compatible. Compatible, well, it is a certain geometric condition which was first described by Franco Magri in his paper in 78. And from that particular paper, we know that every compatible pair generates an integrable system. So in this sense, the WDVD equations are generators of integrable systems. Such integrable systems have a nice geometric theory describing them. And the integrable systems, which stems from a solution of the WDVD equation. And they are what now people nowadays call Frobenius manifolds or Dubrovin Frobenius manifolds. So invariants of Hamiltonian pairs with respect to the Miura group have been introduced and studied. Such invariants are called central invariants and they characterize quasi-linear first order systems of PDEs under the action of the Miura group, which is a group of differential substitution. It's quite involved. It is infinite dimensional and still many things are not completely understood about the action of this group. Okay, then let us have a look to the WDVD equations in detail. I will follow Dubrovin's presentation on the Encyclopedia of Mathematics. So the problem is finding a function of capital N real variables such that the third or first condition, the third order derivatives where one coordinate is fixed and it is T1, it is distinguished from the others. So such third order derivatives are a constant symmetric non-degenerate matrix. Then by means of this matrix, you can raise indices or you can invert the matrix and denote it by upper indices. Eta, gamma, epsilon in the condition number two. And these numbers, C, gamma, alpha, beta, are required to be the structure constants of an associative algebra. In order to fulfill the associativity condition is non-linear in terms of the structure constants of the associative algebra, it's quadratic. And this is the proper WDV equation. And it is an equation on the unknown F. If you do a further requirement, the requirement is the requirement of quasi homogeneity. So the fact that you can bring some multiplication by scalars, the scale transformation, you can bring it outside the function f. This is the property of quasi homogeneity. So you are restricting the subset of possible solutions to a certain the set of possible solutions of WDVD equation to a certain subset. Here is a description of the algebra, which is indeed can be interpreted as an algebra of a tangent bundle of a certain manifold, the Frobenius manifold. Okay, then the WDVV equation sped up completely is the following quadratic equation. So it's nonlinear, it's third order, it is polynomial. And it has a number of interesting properties. So these WDVV equations are still a very interesting object in field theory, in quantum field theory. And if you have a look at some journals in theoretical physics, you see that nowadays they are still under interest, under consideration by many scientists. And by theoretical physicists in particular. The mathematical interest is the fact that, the solutions correspond to integrable hierarchies, but solutions are also related with Gromov-Witten invariants. There are famous mathematical results by Kantsevich concerning the solutions of WDVV equations and enumerative geometry. So here I do not speak about the application in quantum field theory because it's outside my expertise area. I just would like to discuss a bit more in detail how to generate a bi-Hamiltonian pair from a solution of WDVV equations. So if you take a solution with a certain homogeneity degree, we can raise two indices in the third order derivatives of the function capital F, and then obtain this set of functions, of constants, sorry. No, this is a set of functions. If you fix P1 is an operator of Dubrovnikov type of the first order that we saw before. It is of the simplest type because its coefficient matrix is the coefficient matrix of first order derivatives is constant. So it's quite trivially a Hamiltonian operator. But here in this case, the matrix eta is exactly the inverse of the matrix of third order derivatives of F with one derivative, which is at least one derivative is with respect to T1. And then you can construct the P2. P2 is constructed in the following way. We know that it's a theorem by Dubrovin and Novikov that P2 is Hamiltonian if and only if this G is a flat contravariant metric, and these gamma ijk are, Christoffel symbols in upper indices notation of this metric gij. So if you construct G, you have constructed the operator. And you can construct G exactly from the functions that I said above here, C delta gamma beta. So that each time you find the solution F, you can find a bi-Hamiltonian pair of compatible operators. So, and by well-known mechanism, you start from Casimir and apply the so-called Magri recursion, you obtain an integrable system of PDEs of the form which we described before, so a quasi-linear system of the first order. Okay, so WDVV equations come with this unknown third-order matrix of third-order derivatives, which is constant, as I told you. Well, Dubrovin proved that invariance transformations, so symmetry transformations of WDVV equations can bring the matrix eta in two canonical forms. One is the anti-diagonal form, purely anti-diagonal form, and another is anti-diagonal, more than anti-diagonal because it is anti-diagonal identity, similar to the identity, but the diagonal is the other one. The second one has a structure which is very close to the previous one with the only exception of the first coefficient eta 1 1, which is a constant and is non-zero. And in these two cases, capital F has the forms which are described in the slides. So it is completely specified by the fact that it's third order derivatives with respect to D1 are specified and the quasi homogeneity requirement. So the dependence on T1 is completely specified, but the dependence on T2 and so on until Tn is unknown. And it is concentrated into this unknown function small f, which depends on a number of variables, which is capital N minus one. And the same in the second case, exactly the same. Okay, so in these two cases, you have two WDV equations. The first one has been widely studied. The second one is much less studied because I think, well, until some years ago, there were absolutely no physical applications of this second equation. I would like to consider both. And by a trick developed by Alek Mohov many years ago, one can introduce new variables. Basically, you introduce a new letter for every x derivative of f. So for every third order derivative of f, which contains at least one x derivative. X is t2, and then t is t3 in this simplification of the notation. And then what happens is that you can transform the WDV equation into a system of conservation laws of quasi-linear first order type or hydrodynamic type. So the first system to the left corresponds to eta 1, the first canonical form, or this first simplest WDV equation. The second, which is more difficult, corresponds to this system. So the system to the left was proved to be bi-Hamiltonian by a third order operator of Dubrovnik-Novikov type and the first order operator, Hamiltonian operator of Dubrovnik-Novikov type. And what about the system on the right? Nothing was known until, well, a short time ago. So what are higher order homogeneous operators by Dubrovin and Norkov? The operators have this form. Well, they have exactly a fixed number of x derivatives in each summand. So this is, for example, R2 is a second degree homogeneous operator and R3 is a third degree homogeneous operator. We will be focused on the third degree homogeneous operators. Well, what happens is that the simplest WDV equation is by Hamiltonian, well, as I told you, and it was known since this paper in 97. This is the bi-Hamiltonian pair of the first WDV equation. So this is first order and this is third order. So what is the difference between the integrable systems which are given by solutions of WDV equation? That the equation, the WDV equation itself is bi-Hamiltonian. Its solutions are bi-Hamiltonian systems and the equation is also bi-Hamiltonian, but it's bi-Hamiltonian in a different way. Because it's not by Hamiltonian by a pair of first order operators, but by a pair of a first and the third order operator. It can be proved that also the third order operator is completely determined by its leading term. In particular, a new result says that if you consider the canonical form of the third order operator, which is known since long ago by Gennady Vadiomin, a former student of Novikov. Okay, then this canonical form is invariant under reciprocal transformations, which correspond to a projective transformation of the dependent variables. So a reciprocal transformation of projective type is indeed a local transformation, projective transformation of dependent variable plus a non-local transformation of X. It's a local transformation of the differential of x, but it's not integral, it's not holonomic. So these are new results. The operators can be classified. There is a long story about the classification of third order homogeneous operators because they can be classified using the action of projective transformations. I will not spend time on it. I would like to speak about The latest results on WDVB, which were published quite recently by Jakub Bohasic, so the results are that in the cases in low dimensions, both canonical forms of WDVB equations admit a third order homogeneous Hamiltonian operator in canonical form, so in the following form here. So 1dx is to the left, 1dx to the right, and then you have a first order operator in the middle. If you have a look at this, which is our main example, you see that this operator can be factorized exactly according with the canonical formula that I shown in this slide here. 1dx outside, 1dx inside, and one first order operator in the middle. So, but what about by Hamiltonian formalism? Well, it happens that in the case n equals 3, also the second canonical form of WDV equations admits a first order homogeneous operator, but it is much more difficult to find it because it's non-local of the Ferapontov type. And this means that the calculations are quite challenging, but the most difficult part is proving compatibility. And indeed, this is also a result that this operator is compatible with the third order one. And this was made possible by recent results by, okay, many people, Renzoni, Casati, Valeri, and me. All together, we made two papers. We wrote two papers about how to compute the compatibility with a non-local operator of Ferapontov type, but more generally of weakly non-local type, which is a family introduced by Maltsev and Novikov 20 years ago. So in the case n equals 3, the Hamiltonian pair is invariant with respect to the invariance transformation of WDV. So however you choose your WDV equation, however you choose this eta matrix, then it will be, you will obtain in the end the Hamiltonian system. Okay, here I show the form of the Hamiltonian pair in the case of second canonical form of eta for WDV in dimension capital N equals 3. So as you see, it's not so easy to find the third order operator. And for the first order, it's even more complicated because it is of Ferapontov type, and it has constants here, alpha equals to minus mu square, gamma equals mu, and beta is zero, but it is different from zero in other examples, so you have to add all the sums. And so this is defined by the metric which you see here in the picture, and the expression are quite complicated, but you can find some logic in the sense that here in the denominator, there is always the determinant of this, which is quite important because this metric, indeed, as you see these words in the red, it corresponds to a projective variety, which is a quadratic line complex. It is the Monge metric of the quadratic line complex. This is a projective variety in, well, it's a variety of lines. So it's found using after by a quadratic equation in the space of lines of a projective space. So it's quite interesting that to every WDV equation, you are able to associate the projective variety, and this projective variety rules integrability. So it's quite surprising. Okay, so this is about invariance. I already told it, and I would like to show you what happens in dimension 4. You have a system of conditions on the small f, which I shown you before. And this system can be made into two commuting hydrodynamic type systems of conservation laws. They are first order. And it can be shown that they are both by Hamiltonian, by a pair of a third order and a first order operator, in this case local. Okay, this is a result by Maxim Pavlov and me some years ago, but it can be proved that also other cases, so this is for eta 1, but also eta 2 has a third order operator, The third order operator can be found also in N, capital N equals 5. Computations are terrible, but can be found. For first order operator, we still did not find, but at this point, I think that we can formulate the conjecture that such operators do exist in all dimensions. I mean, the WDVV equations are bi-Hamiltonian in all dimensions, but this is at the moment only a conjecture. Okay, so these are the papers that I was discussing before. In these papers, we describe new algorithm and software for computing with weakly non-local operators and the operators that I discussed in the talk. So there is a lot of projected geometry behind the rug in the talk. I did, we did a lot of computations in this paper in order to have our main results, but for sure, the fact that there is a quadratic line complex for every WDVV equation is an intrinsic property of the WDVV equation in initial coordinates. So it's a property that you can read off from the special structure of such equations in the third order jet space. But this is currently under investigation and I have no news about it still. There is some hope to find properties of the solutions which are determined by the existence of the quadratic line complex. But this is at the moment is just a conjecture. I would like to add that also F manifolds, which are a straightforward generalization of Frobenius manifolds, show that the quadratic line complexes exist also there in the equations for F manifold. So it cannot be pure chance, all these algebraic geometric structure. So, okay, here I described the way I did symbolic computations. I used the package developed by myself with several collaborations. I was pushed and helped on the theoretical part by my friends and colleagues and long-term co-workers, Josef Krasinschik and Ali Perbodetsky, that I would like to thank for their encouragement. Okay, so I would like to finish this talk saying that I was wondering how much Andrei cooperated with people in my department, and it turned out that he wrote at least 34 papers with people in the Department of Physics of the University of Lecce, which is now Università del Salento. And for this reason, I think that Andrei was one of the external person that contributed more to the growth of our departments, mathematics and physics. And I would like to thank him very much in the name of all these people and wish him happy, long life and prosperity for many, many years. And I hope to see him again here as soon as this pandemic will give us a chance. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Raffaele. Fantastic. I never counted number of papers, really 34. Fantastic. It was a really nice time to work in Lecce. Thank you very much. And hope to be there again.
Thank you. Thanks to you. Thank you. Big thanks. A big thank is due to you.
Okay, thank you.
Well, thank you for the talk, and we have some time for questions before the next one. If you want to ask, if any. But if not, thank you for the talk once again.
Thank you very much.